Vivek Jagtap. I work with housing.com and available on web with this ID. So I'll be talking about isolated components today. So before we talk about what are these isolated components, let's talk about where it comes from. So in React, we know everything is a component, and our components comes in different flavors. We have skinny components, smart or dumb components. Then you have stateful, pure components, container or presenter components. And our belief with these components and expectation is that components means separation of concerns. Separation of concerns means decoupled system, and that leads to a easily maintainable system, right? So we start creating components all over. So all our application are bundled with different components. So you can see, we start creating a drop-down component. We might have an image component which will load image for you on different resolutions and at different places in your app. And some dumb renderer which will render based on your subscription types. And button component, modal component, and so on. So the problem with these components is that as your application grows, your components also start growing like crazy. And you might reach to a stage where you'll start reusing your components at different places. So you can see the dumb renderer we are reusing at different places. But soon you might reach to this stage where you'll have so many dependencies of your components and you have no clue what is using what and what is being used by which component or which container component, right? So at Housing, we thought to give some meaning to our React components, and we call them as isolated components. So what are these isolated components? So we gave them a responsibility of fulfilling our business use cases. So they are not dumb container components which just holds your different presenter components or a combination of different dumb renderers. And they are truly decoupled because we'll be building them in isolation. So they are completely decoupled with your actual application code. You don't get store, you don't get any of your application code with it. So what business use case we are talking about? So let's say at Housing, user is browsing a property and he's interested in one of the property. So he'll go and try to contact an agent to indicate his interest, right? So user will try contacting an agent. So first step goes like this, like let's verify this user. Once he submits his details, we'll have to verify him. Is a verified user? No. We'll ask him to put an OTP. And after OTP verification, we'll submit his details to an agent and we'll reveal agent's details. And in some other case, if user is verified, we'll directly reveal these details to a user. Now there are lots of things happens even after submission, right? So we'll be pushing some relevant ads as well to a user. Then there is something called based on phone number, we'll log him in to our system. Now you can see logging him based on phone number is also been taken care of by another isolated component. So this is how the business use case looks like in your actual app. So user tries to contact, he'll fill in details. Not a verified user, so we ask for OTP, puts in OTP, and yep, success screen comes. You can see here he's logged in, and we push some relevant ads, and we also sync his profile details here, right? So how do we create these isolated components? So before we move on to that, what is the reason to create in isolation? So this is a simple example of a contact form where you need to solve a business use case. But what if you want to replicate the same logic across your devices? So the thing which works on mobile, you want to replicate the same business use case on desktop, but maybe with a different view layer, right? Now, maintaining such complications is not easy, right? So the solution to this is create your components in isolation So we'll use a React Storybook or React Isolate, any of these tools, to create them in isolation. We'll test them in isolation using Jest or WebDriver.io. And at last, we bundle it and publish them as an NPM module. So this is how you create. This is a Karira Storybook. It's a playground for creating your different React components. So you can see on left panel, we have different use cases. And on right, a particular story is getting rendered. So I'll just play for you. Sorry. So this is in isolation. This is this we built it in apart from our actual application code base. State and then some apps. Yep. Now you can toggle here between your different use case, like how it will look for a verified user. So I can click on this. Yep, this is how it will look for verified users. And if I toggle back, this is how it will look for unverified users, right? Now, once you build them and you test them, like it works fine, you bundle them and publish them as an NPM module. Then wherever you want to use it, you just add it as a dependency in your project, whether it's your desktop app or whether it's your mobile app. So at Housing, a year back or so, when we moved to PWA, we moved our code base, we separated out our repos for mobile and desktop. So then it started becoming difficult for us to maintain this kind of business use case to replicate in both the places. So this is where it's helpful for you. So just include it in a desktop as well as mobile application code, and to use it, just pass in the data it needs. Then it takes care of handling entire thing, like whether to show OTP, whether to show push relevant ads, or what to do, or whether to log him in. Everything has been taken care by this isolated component. So this is an example of one isolated component working across different devices. State, login in, push some relevant ads, right? So this is a debatable question, like what do you do with your stores? Like your application will be working on one store. So how does isolated components get access to your application store? So this is a debatable question. I'll not deep dive into this. But for us, what we wanted is we wanted a plug and play mechanism where you just plug a component and it should start working on its own. So we did this, created a different store altogether where we just specify a key, like which key to work on. So with provider, create provider, you can specify a store key in which key context you should, provider should create store for you. Yeah, by default it's store and you can give your custom key. And then in connect, there's another option for store key where you can say, like which context it needs to read store from. Yep. Now the question comes is how does two isolated components talk to each other? So you have a login component, you have a contact component. After contact component, you want to make sure that user also gets logged in based on his contact details. So right now we have a callbacks and each and every steps, but we can replace them with any event mechanism or dispatch an action. Maintenance, yeah, I mean, it's pretty easy for us now. We just change things at one place and we upgrade the version and publish them again on NPM. So any updates are pretty easy for us. Test it at one place, write it at one place and use it at multiple places. Yeah, we keep tweeting cool stuff at Housing. So thanks.
Yeah, can you hear me? No? Oh, okay.
Yeah,
thanks for the presentation. You said you use callbacks for them to talk to each other. Are you using a function as a child in the React component to do that?
Sorry, I didn't get the last one.
Are you using like a function as a child inside of the React?
Yeah, we pass a function.
Oh, okay, thanks.
So to have two components talk to each other, there's one component which is like a bridge between two components. So this component tells that, okay, this is the data which I give you. Then what to do on that data has been taken care by any other component. No questions?
Hi. So when you're passing data between two components, can we have a common repo, a common data object, and use them across all the components?
So can you be a bit louder?
Hello?
Yeah.
So when you are connecting two components, right? I mean, traversing from one component to the other component, you are passing the data, right? So rather than passing the data, can we have the data in a common place and use it across multiple components?
What are you talking about? Are you talking about two different isolated components or
yes.
components inside isolated components?
Two different isolated components.
So our idea was not to pollute the global store with these components. These components should have their own states and they work on their own. Now, these components eventually will lead to something. Like contact details leads to a success state where it tells you these are the contact details which got successfully saved. Now, what to do on that is nothing to, I mean, isolated component doesn't have to be care, they don't have to care about all these things. So, you just tells your main application code that this has been done. Now, what to do on that is been taken care of by your other components. So, it doesn't make sense to update it. I mean, my application code might not even update it in the state. And I might need it just for a local reference and I might not need to store that as a state. Does that answer your question?
Hello.
Yeah.
So while having isolated components, where do you maintain your API calls?
API calls, everything. So everything is in component. So we have different actions altogether for this component.
Mm-hmm.
And
so are you using Flux or anything of
that?
We
have a Redux store.
Okay.
Hey, can you hear me? Okay, good talk, man. So we actually wanted to do this as well. One concern we had was sharing styles between mobile and desktop.
Exactly.
You showed us a component that kind of looked the same.
We had a problem. We have a different build system for mobile and desktop.
So you kind of extract it out or something?
Yeah, what we do is we just ship transpiled code to a mobile and desktop. And then those two different folders take care of the mobile build process will take care of how do you ship it. How it will ship and desktop code will take care of how does it ship it to production.
Is there a particular way you guys do this? Like, is there a webpack?
No, we're using normal webpack for mobile and normal self-process
awesome.
For
Thanks.
Desktop.
Thanks a lot.
So, if you have a same build process across your devices, like desktop and mobile, then it makes sense that when you publish your module, that time only you bundle it in a way that the way your both the build process works and then you publish it.
Yeah, hello. So how do you decide what should be a component, like where is the line between
things? Yeah, yes, exactly. I wanted to mention this in a talk. So complex scenarios like this, and when you feel that these kind of things will get replicated. So this is just an example which I gave for mobile and desktop. But in desktop itself, there are different view parts. So the way you show pop-up for contact modal in different flow, user might see it directly rendered in the app. So, and maybe in a different view part. So, when you see that it's been reused at multiple places and in some different way, but your business logic, like core logic of doing things remains same, then you know, okay, this is the trigger point for you to make them in isolation. Yeah?
I think that was it for questions.
A last question, please.
Oh, do we have one last question? All right. If you cut into the next speaker's time, I'm going to find you at lunch.
Yeah. Have you got components for Ajax and Promises as well? Because that's a good standard.
These are the common libraries, we can say, but they are not components. So, this isolation components, main intent is to solve your business use case, how the user flow happens, and not a particular library. So, library we import as a dependency, and then it works
like
seamlessly.
No custom components.
Cool. Thanks. All right. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you very much.